We have come together in the presence of God and in the name of Christ. We come with sorrow but also with hope to express our loss, but also to give thanks, to recognize death, but also to celebrate life, to look back on all that has been, but also to look forward to all that is yet to be. So come then in faith, for God is here. The God who promised that in life or death, he is with us. The God who gives all who truly believe the assurance of his eternal blessing. So on behalf of the members of Clifford Methodist Church, I welcome you all here today. I particularly welcome you, Catherine, Stephen, Sarah, Ian, Richard, and other members of Michael's family and friends. And also the wider friends, neighbours and church family and other associates of Michael Whaley, whose life we are remembering today. For those of you who don't know, my name is Steve Jakeman. I'm the minister of this church. And Michael's farewell service took place a little earlier at Stonefall, led by our local pastor, Donald Mill. It is now my privilege to guide us through this service of thanksgiving. My prayers will not only be a fitting tribute to Michael, but also a service that will be helpful for us all, helping us through the inevitable grieving process we go through. Michael was a committed member of this church. He took on many roles, latterly as property secretary, and was a keen supporter of the many events and services that took place. So Michael was used to notices being given out before a service. In fact, many a time he did it himself. I'm sure he'd written out to him about three notices just to help us prepare for what will happen over the next half an hour, 45 minutes or so. Firstly, this is to be a service of thanksgiving, an opportunity to give thanks to God for the life of Michael Whaley, who has already been commended to God. So I encourage you to join in the celebration as best as you can. The mood for the worst of it will be positive, which is very much in keeping with Michael. So join in as best as you can, but be true to your own emotions, allowing God at this time to minister to our needs. I'd expect a smile at times, but also a tear, and both are perfectly acceptable. Secondly, the family would be pleased if you join them in the schoolroom for some refreshments afterwards. We were supposed to be showing a montage of pictures on there, but technology being what it is, and Michael would have understood that. It's not showing at the moment here, with the polygraphs here, but it will be playing in the schoolroom. So please stay if you can, even for only 10 minutes. Because in my experience, it's a really good way to not only pay your respects to the family, but also to share some memories and some stories. I'm pretty sure there'll be quite a few of those. Very likely. So please stay if you can. And finally, if after the service you feel moved to make a donation in Michael's memory, then we will ensure that any money will be given to support the amazing and supportive work at Gents Hospice and Cancer Research UK. There's a plate at the back, should you serve it? So let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we come with gratitude in our hearts for all that Michael has meant to us, and for all he continues to mean to us, and for all he will always mean to you. Please be with us at this time. Draw near to us, we draw near to you. Speak to us through the words of Scripture and tribute. Through our hymns and our prayers. And through all we share. So that believing in the good news of Christ and trusting in him, we may receive the comfort he promises. The peace that passes all understanding. And the assurance of everlasting life. Comfort us as we remember before you our loved one Michael. As we reflect on all the different aspects of his life. Grant us the courage to celebrate his life as you would want it to be celebrated. And the wisdom and insight to learn from those aspects we most admire in him. Lift us, we pray, from any sorrow we feel. Ease our loneliness. And give us the courage to let go of Michael as we face the future. Be with us as our guide and strength. Give us your peace and the knowledge of your constant love. Love that is available through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
At our committal service, my committal service early today, Psalm 23 was read. We're now going to sing Stuart Tamlin's version of that psalm. As we sing, the Lord's my shepherd.
Upset,
Jesus told them, believe in God and believe also in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house, and I am going to prepare a place for you. I would not tell you this if it were not so. And after I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to myself, so that you will be where I am. You know the way that leads to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way to get there? Jesus answered him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except by me. Now that you have known me, he said to them, you will know my Father also. And from now on, you will know him, and you have seen him. Peace is what I leave you with. It is my own peace that I give you. I do not give it as the world does. Do not be worried and upset. Do not be afraid. Amen.
Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way to get there? In that story we just heard, Jesus was telling his disciples that he was going to die, as we were. But they weren't to be worried or upset. And Thomas, one of the disciples who'd been with Jesus for 3 years, who'd heard him teach wonderful things, actually seeing him heal people with dreadful illnesses, seeing him have command over nature, tell the sea to quieten down. Still, he said basically, it's all very well for you to say, don't worry. And I don't understand. I can't get my head around what you're saying. To which Jesus' response was effectively, stay with me, I'll see you through. And he makes that same offer to us there. Stay with me, and I'll see you through. But through to where? My notes say, we've seen some great photos up on the screen. In school and afterward, we will see some great photos up on the screen, but there's one thing I'd like to concentrate on. You can look at the back of your research and we've got sight of that. What are Michael and the kids looking at? Is it something on the rocks in front? A bird nesting on the cliff? A boat out at sea? Or is it just the line of the horizon in the distance? It reminds me of a few years ago when I kayaked across the channel. Yes, I know it's hard to believe that looking at me now. Now my wife Fiona was going to film me for rating this story. She was in France on a cliff, very much like this one, looking out over the water. And she knew I was about 6 miles out, but she couldn't see me. So she rang my son, who's in the Navy and knows about this stuff, and asked, if he's 6 miles away, should I be able to see him? And his response was, oh, can you see the white cliffs of Dover? Yes. Well, they're 21 miles away. So yes, he's within sight, but he's probably very small. A bit like that classic Father Ted sketch where Doom couldn't go work out by the 0.8 pounds on the table in front of him looked to be the same size as the real ones in the field, far away. It's all about perspective. If I stood at the front door of this chapel, my horizon would be the far side of the car park. I just couldn't see any further. If I walked up Windmill Hill, just a couple of miles down the road, which I'm sure you've walked times, yeah, Michael, I reckon from there I can see New York Minster, maybe on a good day to the North York Moors. Yeah. If I look through the James Webb Space Telescope, I know you don't want to look through it, but if I could to see what they could see, I'd see a red smudge that is thought to be a galaxy 13.5 billion light years away. Astronomers believe we're seeing something that existed just 235 million years after the Big Bang, which in astronomical terms is the blink of an eye. That entire concept would have been unbelievable, outside anybody's grasp of imagination, just a few years ago. And yet, those of us who were at Stonefall earlier heard the Apostle Paul say, he believed there was nothing. No power, nothing in all creation, certainly no distance, and not even death, that could separate us from the love of God shown to us in Jesus. When someone we love dies, the world says, medicine says, that's it. That's the horizon. That's the end. Christians don't believe that. Jesus told his followers that after death he would be waiting for. They weren't to worry that at this stage they didn't understand. They didn't need the map. We've got the map out there and it is open up again. Just stick with him and he'll see them through. Through to somewhere beyond our current ability to see, over the horizon. There's a lovely poem by Henry Van Dyke. I'm standing upon the seashore, and ship at my side spreads her white sails to the morning breeze and starts for the blue ocean. She is an object of beauty and strength. I stand and watch her until at length she hangs like a speck of white cloud, just where the sea and the sky come to mingle with each other. Then, someone at my side says, "Dead." She's gone. Gone where? Gone from my sight, that's all. She is just as large in mast and hull and spar as she was when she left my side. And she is just as able to bear her load of living freight to her destined port. A diminished size is in me, not in her. And just at that moment when someone at my side says, "There," she's gone. There are other eyes watching her coming, and other voices ready to take up the glad shout, "Here she comes." And that is dying. Jesus didn't make the promise to help us through, or just make the promise to help us through. He died on a cross and came back to show us that there is more than we can see or imagine. Michael isn't just at peace in the sense of no longer in pain. He is with God. As Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid.
Thank you, Donald. We're going to sing again now as we think of that ship going to the horizon. We sing, "Make me a channel of your peace."
His quest for adventure and to see the world is the sort of summer holidays that our classmates were always envious of. He taught us to be curious and keen travellers, both at home and far away. And whether he was getting in the way of my great New Yorkers as he tried to take his 100th photo of the Empire State Building, much to Sam's embarrassment, or setting off on his bicycle wearing his fluorescent cycling clips, much to anyone's embarrassment, he was always quite happy just being him and being out and about in the world. Dad was always there for us, and no task was too great an ask. From decorating living rooms to standing in the rain with broken down cars, or moving us in and out of numerous universities over the years. There was never a grumble or a moan, but he always genuinely was pleased to help us as we progressed through our lives. I asked my dad, I'm sure Dad will know, or I bet Dad is a tool for that, were frequently said, and usually turned out to be true. He showed us how much he cared through these acts of kindness, and by being a constant presence, quietly reliable, and an unwavering well of support. And he could always be counted on to provide a source of entertainment too. Family dinners could go on far longer than planned, thanks to Dad laughing often at his own jokes, or restarting a story that he'd already tried to tell three times already. A family favourite was his habit of misremembering common proverbs, so that he would sagely inform us that a rolling horse gathers no moss, or that too many soups spoil your dinner, which in retrospect does sort of make sense. On one occasion, his acting credentials were put to the test when trying to renew his subscription with the unsuspecting staff of the Telegraph newspaper subscription team. When told that Mo was the account holder, he made the questionable decision not to wait for her to return, but instead to attempt to impersonate her. Deciding he would also be more convincing if he put on a highly unbelievable Scottish accent. That's the sound of hearing like Mrs. Doubtfire. The person on the other end of the phone must have taken a bit of though, because I believe you've got a discount. Dad loved to be silly and get others laughing too. Even if that was sometimes acting rather than with him, he always maintained a certain childlike enthusiasm too. And family members on a nice country walk would have to keep their wits about him, as he had a real penchant for running ahead before finding a suitable hiding spot from which he could jump out unsuspecting locals. He taught us to be adventurous and relish the world we live in. He taught us to put others first and treat everyone with kindness. And he taught us that, in his words, you've got to get on in life, encouraging us to face our fears, whether riding a bike without stabilizers or taking a driving test. Dad's first instinct was always to teach and encourage, and we will always be incredibly grateful for those lessons and for the time invested in each of us. Whether for raising children of our own, or simply for appreciating and enjoying our time with family and friends, we've all been given a wonderful example to follow.
Thank you, Richard. And now I invite Catherine to share.
No one would be more surprised than Michael to see so many people here today. I think he would say, didn't he know so many people? And that was because he was a very humble and unassuming man. Michael just got on with things without any fuss in his own inimitable way. He called himself a problem. And it didn't matter whether plodding referred to how he walked up the mountain, or whether it meant starting from scratch as he did to create two new shower rooms in our house. He plodded at it, carefully and steadily. He certainly wouldn't have wanted to pay him by the hour. Michael simply enjoyed the challenge. And every day I stand in that shower and marvel at his hand. But plodding would definitely not be the word that you would describe the young Michael with. He grew up in Burton in Lonsdale and in Ingleton, and found it rather irksome to be reminded that he was born in a nursing home the wrong side of the Lancashire border. As a child, he cycled everywhere, and he was given an inordinate amount of freedom. At 12, I believe, he cycled to Devon on holiday, on his own, staying over in youth hospitals en route. even younger than that, he'd often tell his mum he'd decided to spend a day walking up Ingleborough. And she simply asked him what he wanted in his sandwiches. He cherished this freedom in the countryside all his life. An only child, until he was 9 years old, he was, I believe, knocked a bit off kilter when Sister Christine came along. He admitted to me that he nipped and prodded her a bit. She, however, remembers idolising her big brother. And then when Andrew came along another 5 years later, Michael would entertain them by giving them rides in the bread basket at the front of his bike. Health and safety hadn't been invented. In addition to being the original homeless lad delivering bread around the village, Michael was very industrious with other jobs. He had a paper round. I think, I might be wrong, he had a job at Settle Dairy for a while. And certainly later he was a guide to tourists in the White Star Cave at Ingleton. You got pound for a day, haven't you? But a lot more if your jokes were good, they give you the tips. And he was also a post office assistant at Christmas time, helping deliver parcels to remote Dale farms on a two-wheeled wicker basket following her lantern. Such was his nostalgia from his youth that he never ceased regaling stories about it to all of us. And she got him started. After teacher training college in Leicestershire, came a career in schools, just four in all. The archetypal school teacher of the 1970s is pictured in your old service. Starting with his first job in Keighley, Michael was always happy working in the primary sector where his enthusiasm was infectious. His second post in Lincolnshire was as head teacher of a small primary near now where Steve and his family live. He was just 26 years old. The children in his schools were always at his heart. Meetings and admin are very distant things. We met at his next school, Tadcaster East. I'd been there just a year when the new head arrived. Mr. Whaley and his staff did not get on. Details on request. Although he did tell me later that he hadn't noticed we weren't friendly. He always loved being involved with the children, whether it was residential visits, end of year productions for the older children, or being the pancake inspector for the infants. And apparently raiding the dressing up box to impress the 5-year-olds with a costume. I bet they didn't know a pancake inspector wore a crown, did you? In Sherburn Hungate, he spent his final 7 years of his career. His deputy tells me he was loved by all and very approachable, a wise sounding board for the staff to go to. Even parents who came with a complaint often left with a smile. A group of mums came to him moaning about a continuous problem in primaries, head lice. They knew who the culprit was, and they wanted their children moving into another class on the very least inside the room. "Well, there's a much more simple solution, ladies," said Mike. "Just need to get my hair cut like mine." They left children. In spite of having heavy responsibilities, Michael never worried about things. His answer to problems was, "I'll sleep on it." He never lost in our entire married life a night's sleep. And he'd often come up with a solution to the problem by the morning. Michael was a young father to Stephen and to Ian in the 70s, and a more mature dad when Sarah and Richard came along. Indeed, as he paired around the play parks, the other children would ask, "Will your granddad chase me with him?" And indignant Richard always put them right. Michael on the hand found it very funny. On some Sunday holidays, we travelled by car into Europe. Always keen to impart geographical knowledge, the recurring theme I feel, rarely did he receive such enthusiastic responses. "Yes, Dad, eyes still on the novel. You showed us a dossier yesterday." We also had lovely holidays in Britain and days out walking the hills and the dales in Yorkshire. Michael always loved maps. In fact, I think we've kept on in the survey going with our butcher for all his cooking. And his enthusiasm for walking has percolated down to the next generation. He was always thrilled to hear that his children had been doing walks, many of which he'd shown them first. When I retired too, we decided to travel. Australia was the first big adventure to visit him. But I could also see how much pleasure Michael got from planning the trips for months beforehand. We went to many far-flung destinations over the years, and we loved them all. But looking back, Michael was equally happy just being at home, being with family, or pottering around the little garden. He never asked for much, but he always gave a lot. He was always there for me. Seeing so many of you here today, I know his life has touched many other lives. There can't be many folk in this world who are completely happy in their own skin. Michael was. Nor are there many who never say an unkind word about others. Michael never did. He will be sorely missed. Never forgot. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. That is a wonderful man. We've now had an opportunity to reflect on our own memories of Michael as we listen to a piece of music by Christopher.
I was looking at a photograph taken in the garden long before the war. And there were old men and dogs and little children. All I've known, all I've known. Never been one but a smile, standing in the same place where I am today. Nothing is true, but you know that time is moving around. You can only love forever. Across the space between the father and the son. when we're out. We don't say all the words that should be spoken. For they are lost, so we'll know. I was too young for a while, taking hold of every word. We are alone. We must be too gone for our children. But we are gone.
We know the Bible continues to shine on beyond. That's one of those. Now, where death is going to read the poem to us. The joy of living.
I'm not being as great as St. Catherine. And I would like you to watch in the Michael saying these words. Farewell, you northern hills, you mountains, oh, goodbye. Moorlands and stony ridges, cracks and peaks, goodbye. Glidafac, farewell, Kulbiag, Scafell, cloud-bearing Sulben, sun-warmed rocks and the cold of Bleaklow's frozen sea. The snow and the wind and the rain of hills and mountains, days in the sun and the tempered wind and the air like wine. And you drink and you drink till you're drunk on the joy of living. Farewell to you, my love, my time is almost done. Lie in my arms once more until the darkness comes. You filled all my days, held the night at bay, dearest companion. Years pass by and are gone with the speed of birds in flight. Our lives like the verse of a song, heard in the mountains. Give me your hand and love and join your voice with mine. And we'll sing of the hurt and the pain and the joy of living. Farewell to you, my chicks, for you must fly alone. Flesh of my flesh, my future life, bone of my bone. May your wings be strong, may your days be long, safe in your journey. Each of you bears inside of you the gift of love. May it bring you light and warmth and pleasure of giving. Eagerly savour each new day and the taste of its mouth. Never lose sight of the thrill and the joy of living. Take me to some high place of heather, rock and limb. Scatter my dust and ashes, feed me to the wind, so that I may be part of all you see, the air you are breathing. I'll be part of the curlew's cry and the soaring hawk, the blue milk water and the sundew, home with diamonds. I'll be riding the gentle breeze as it blows through your hair, reminding you how we share in the joy of living.
Thank you. So let's pray. We thank you, O God, for the life of Michael. We thank you for all he was as a much loved husband, father, grandfather, brother, and friend. For the relationships he shared with so many, family, friends, neighbors, church friends, and our community. We thank you for his personality, his love and friendship, his honesty and integrity, his kindness and thoughtfulness, his wisdom and humility, we thank you for his undoubted talents, his unassuming ways, his encouragement of others in life and in faith. And we thank you for his faith and all that he contributed to this church, Methodism, and this community. For his faithful service in so much, his commitment, his discipleship, his witness to the love of Christ. For these and all the blessings and the memories Michael has given to us, we thank you, O God of love. And we ask that you will be with those who mourn his sad loss. Thinking particularly of Catherine, Stephen, Ian, Richard, Sarah, and Michael's wider family and friends. Help them and all of us to cling onto those positive memories of his life. A life well lived and an example to us all. Help those of us who knew him to be proud that they knew and lived alongside him. And help us now to remember that Michael is with you and is at peace, for which we offer our thanks. Amen. Amen. Say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed
be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our closing hymn is How Great Thou Art.
Oh, my God, I'm in love.
May God give to the living grace, to the departed rest, to the world peace, and to us and all the faithful life everlasting. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon you all now and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.